SQL, the reason why it becomes so popular is that it allows programmers or users to only do this. Somehow you can specify what you want without worrying about how to do it, without specifying how to do it in your code. Sounds like magic, right? So I will show you some examples of why this is the case. And when you have this property, when you have a programming language that allows you to do this, specify what you want, but not how to do it, and this is what we call declarative language. Declarative language, okay? So here is a quick example of SQL, right? So the simplest form of a SQL query is select from and where, okay? So we have three clauses, select, from, and where. In this particular example, I do select star from student s where s dot h equals 18. I have already explained the purpose of this variable s, right, in last lecture or the lecture before last lecture. So it basically is a reference to the instance of that relation, right? Reference to the instance of that relation. So it's very intuitive, right? What that means is you are selecting all the students' records whose age value equal to 18. What the heuristic means is that, remember, not only you want to do selection horizontally, meaning what records to be returned, in some cases you also want to do selection vertically. Among the records to be returned, what attributes you really want to print out. Sometimes you do not want to print out all the attributes of those records, right? So the select clause is designed for that purpose. The select clause is to project out the columns or the attributes that you want. When you want to keep all the attributes from the original schema, you use heuristic in this case, right? That means you're printing out all the attributes. The where clause is to do the horizontal selection, meaning the set of records to be returned for this particular query, right? In this case, I'm selecting all the records with age value equal to 18. To give you another example, I do the same thing, but now I want to do both horizontal selection and vertical selection. So this does the horizontal selection. Select only the records with age value equal to 18. And this does the vertical selection. Among those records with age value equal to 18, I'm going to select only the name and login. So the output will be this. Does that make sense? Okay? So fairly simple. So one thing you do notice from this example, very quickly, is this particular language. So this is a mini program, right? This is one program, that's another program. It allows you to specify what you want, but it doesn't really allow you to specify how to do it. If you think about it, the first one, you know, the first example is probably less obvious, because it looks like there's only one way to do this anyway, which is you go through all the student records. For each student record, you check whether age value equals 18. If it does, return that record. Otherwise, you skip and go to the next record. Seems like that's the only way to do it. So it doesn't really matter whether you specify how to do it or not, because there's only one way out. Okay? However, in the second example, there are actually two different ways, at least two different ways, of doing the second program. Can someone tell me what are those possible ways of executing the second quote-unquote program? Yes, can you speak a little bit louder so that people can hear you?
Yeah, so
you don't have to specify two different approaches. As long as you give me one approach, that's good enough. Then I will ask another one to try to come up with a second approach. Okay, sure. No worries. Okay, I will give one approach, then see whether someone else can complement my approach with another different approach. The first how to do it, is very simple, right? You do exactly the same as before, meaning iterate through all the student records one by one, check whether age value equal to 18. If it does, what do you do? Instead of returning the entire student record, you return only those two attributes in the select clause. Do a for loop for each record, check this, then return this. Approach number one, right? Is there a different way of doing this?
You do it recursively.
Say again?
You do it recursively.
What do you mean by you do it recursively?
So instead of using a for loop, you can go down, like you can do a merge sort in that sense, where you're sorting data, you're like cutting portions of the database apart to only focus on one area.
I think you kind of right, but let me try to reiterate, see whether that's what you mean, right? Instead of doing a for loop, another approach to doing this is what? I do a sorting based on the age value. Then I do a value search to find the segment with age value 14. Because after you do the sorting, all the student record with age value equal to 18 will be guaranteed to be consecutive to each other in one segment. Then I no longer need to do a linear scan of them, I can find out those records very quickly, right? However, this is quote unquote a really bad approach compared to the first approach, right? Someone tell me why this is a bad approach compared to the first one. To just linear scan, do the for loop.
I was gonna say, do the binary search that
yes, has to be sorted by age value. But why this is a better approach compared to just do the for loop?
Sorting it will be more expensive.
Yeah.
More expensive than
sorting is always more expensive than doing a linear scan. Right? Why do you want to do this? There's no point. The first approach is linear approach, right? It's linear, meaning the cost is linear. You look at each record once. Sorting, what's the cost of sorting? Is at least n log n, right? So it's more expensive. So it doesn't make sense to do this, right? Nevertheless, this is another way of doing it. But is there another, this is actually not the second approach I refer to. Is there another approach that can potentially be more efficient than the first approach?
If you keep it sorted, then you will
if you,
have to do
yes. If you know your table is already sorted, yes, you can, you know, instead of doing a for loop, you can do manual search directly. And the cost of that is just log n. That make sense? But what if data is not sorted? Another approach is the first approach I mentioned is to do the horizontal selection first. Okay? A linear scan through all the records, then for each record with h value to 18, I put all the attributes. Well, why don't you do a vertical selection first? Why don't you do vertical selection first? Meaning, I find out only those two attributes in the select clause, but that's not sufficient because I need the age attribute in order to do the horizontal selection. So from the original table, what I will do is I will take this column, and this column. Without looking at these two columns. If there's a way for me to do that, then I can take these three attributes first. Then for those ones, for those three columns, I check whose age value is 18. Which is more efficient, the vertical selection or the horizontal selection? Well, it's hard to tell, right? In this case, looks like the horizontal selection is more efficient. But imagine I give you a case where you have large number of records, and you have a very large number of columns, like millions of columns, or at least thousands of columns. The horizontal selection means that you have to look at all the columns from a single record each time to just look at three attributes at the end of the day. Even if a record has hundreds or thousands of attributes, you are only looking at only three attributes per record. But in order to check those three, you need to load the entire record. Does that make sense? That's very expensive, right? If you can narrow down to those three columns initially very quickly, just looking at these three columns, imagine you have many, many other columns you don't have to look at, the vertical cut will be more efficient than the horizontal cut. that make sense? So those are two different approaches, at least then plus the sorting. There are many other possible approaches as well. The point I want to illustrate here is when you write this SQL query right here, this code, in this code, it doesn't allow you to specify how to do it. Right? You only specify what you want, but nowhere in this code, in this mini program, you specify how to do it. This is very different from you writing a code in C++ or Java. Does that make sense? You may wonder, okay, wait a minute. In Java, when I do sorting, I just call a function called sort. I don't have to specify how to do it either. Well, that's wrong, right? Because when you call the function sort, somebody else in that code specified how to do it. And it's a specific way of doing that. If you are a really good programmer, you should really look into what that sort means. If it's a bubble sort, never call it. You're super expensive. Look into it. What's in it? Don't just take things for granted. Oh, I call sorting, and it doesn't work for me. No, you have to look into it. What does it do? What does it exactly do? Does it do bubble sort or quick sort? There's a huge difference, by the way, right? N square and log n. If you sort a million items, which is nothing, right? A million items for a company like Google or Microsoft are not even peanuts. Right? Even peanut is too big to represent a million for them. So N square is this, and N log n is how much? Well, log n is, what's log n of mean? Of base 2, of course, right? So I know log base 2 of 1,000 roughly equals to 10, right?
20.
Does that make sense? So then this is about, this is about 20, yes. Less than, basically less than 100 for sure. So this whole thing is less than 10 to the power 8. In this case. So you're looking at 10 to the power 12 versus 10 to the power 8. So less than 10 to the power 8. So the difference is more than 10,000 times. So it's more than 10,000 times more expensive for just sorting a million items. So if I take only 1 second, it will take more than 10,000 seconds. Right? That's more than 3 hours. So I do this in 1 second, you do it in 3 hours. Right? Does it matter? Of course it matters. So database system, on the other hand, the beauty of database system using SQL approach is that you do not have to specify how to do it. But this brings up immediately another question you may ask. Somebody has to do the job, right? Somebody has to do it, right? Cannot be such a beautiful word, right? You just say, I want a house, then you have a house, right there. No, it doesn't work like that. Somebody, somewhere, has to pay the cost. Who is that somebody? Well, that happened in the database kernel. Inside the database engine, we have something called query optimizer and query executor. And they will automatically figure out what we try to do and figure out the best approach of doing it. For example, in this particular example, what query optimizer will do is look at things like what he has suggested. First thing the query optimizer will check if data is already sorted or not. If data is already sorted, I will not do the for loop approach, but I will do a binary search, then only print those little segments with h value to 18. If it's sorted by h, otherwise I will proceed with the for loop potential. That make sense? Okay, so that's a simple example of what query optimizer might do for you.
So just so I understand exactly
yeah.
what you're getting at. What you're saying is basically like with the select or insert or delete, basically any of the black button commands that we can do in SQL, the exact method on how it actually does it code-wise is determined by the database kernel.
That's right.
As an end user, so like I can write select to get specific information, like different, you know, but I can't tell to select based upon like vertical or horizontal.
Almost right, except the last phrase you mentioned. As an end user, so he actually bring up an important question, which is, Does this also mean as an end user, I have no control, no dictation whatsoever over what the query operator will do inside the kernel? I'm powerless in some sense. I only specify what to do. I can only tell my contractor build the house. I cannot tell him or her which window to use and things like that.
Right.
Almost true, except that co-optimization, later on, we will discuss that briefly. Co-optimization is an NP-hard problem, meaning that given a particular SQL query, you cannot hope that the kernel will be able to find the optimal query plan in polynomial time. Okay. If that's the case, then yes, build a house. Basically, you find this perfect constructor will always find the most efficient way of building your house. Then yes, you don't have to worry about anything. But in reality, the reality is, it doesn't work like that. Okay, so co-optimizer cannot solve this problem in polynomial time to find the optimal, the best, the most efficient plan. So what that means is the way you write your query actually matters to what the co-optimizer will do.
That makes sense. Basically,
yeah. So the same query, because there are multiple ways of specifying what you want. You can say build a house, or you can say, oh, I want to do something that I can stay inside that place and prevent me from getting rain and snow, and I can watch TV. You can go like 10 pages describing what you want, or you can say build a house. Obviously, the latter is much easier to optimize than a 10-page document. Essentially, it boils down to, I want to build a house. Okay. Does that make sense?
So is this something that occurs like as you're trying to execute the query, so it's kind of like interpreted in a sense? So each time you have the query, the kernel will try to optimize it, even if it's the same query?
Yeah, that's exactly right. So the way the workflow is, you supply the query in SQL statement. The first thing happening is that the kernel will translate into, this word will be translated into something the kernel can understand. That's something called relational algebra, which we will cover right after the discussion of ER to relational model matching. Then using the relational algebra representation, the kernel will do optimization over that, and then execute the query for you. All this happens automatically inside the kernel without you input. Okay. All right, so this is a simple one. So let me give you a slightly more expensive one. So what does the following query do? Excuse me. So what this query does is, so you have data set across multiple tables, right? The students enrolled and the course example, right? Suppose you want to find out the name of the student and the corresponding CID, the course ID, where that student has received an A grade in that course. In other words, for each student, I want to find what classes he or she has done really well. It could be more than one. Classes he or she done really well, getting an A grade. And for each student, I want to do this. Okay? That's what this query does. So what I'm doing is I want to purge that out, the student name and course ID, from students and enrolled, where you are, you know, putting the two tables together such that you want to make sure they talk about the same student record, which is guaranteed by the first condition over there, student ID equal to student ID. And at the same time, the grade must equal to A, because that's the courses you pick. Okay? Then for those records, you put that out, the student name and course ID.
We have the key to a student, in this case, or key to any item, element. Is it constant time to look that up?
What do you mean? Can you rephrase your question?
If you have a key to something,
okay.
Is it constant time to look at that element, like if you use this?
Oh, that's a, I think I cannot answer that question for now. I will defer that to a later discussion when we talk about index and how the database is actually organized. So keep that question in mind, and we come back in maybe 3 weeks from now, 3-4 weeks. So that's what this query does. And if you have these two instances as inputs, student and involved, this will be the output. There's only one student who ever received an A in some classes, and even for that student, there's only one class he has received an A grade. So that will be the output. Okay? But conceptually, what is happening here? By the way, this example illustrates to you the importance of that variable S or E, right? If you don't use S or E, these variables S and E to represent the student instance and the enrolled instance respectively, in order for you to specify that condition, student ID equal to student student ID equal to enrolled student ID, you have to somehow distinguish the two student ID columns, right? One SID is from students, one SID is from enrolled. You have to somehow distinguish them, right? So without using this variable S or E, what you have to do is use the full relation name to qualify a particular attribute. So what you have to do is students.sid equals enrolled.sid. Okay? If you were not to use those variables S or E. So it simplifies your query, right?
If the system were to see that enrolled has, say, a foreign key constraint
yes.
between the SIDs of both tables,
mm-hmm.
will the optimizer make that optimization and not check the first where condition?
Oh, no, you still have to check that. Foreign key only says student ID come from the other side, but it doesn't tell you which particular record it come from. Right, so student ID might not match up for all possible pairs of combination, right, which what I'm going to show you next. So the semantic of this query is the following. First of all, you execute the from clause. So if you have multiple tables in the from clause, what you do is, let's take two tables as an example. You produce the what we call the cross product of those two tables, those two instances. What is a cross product? Okay? So this refers back to the cross product of two sets. Let's say I have two sets A and B. The cross product of A and B is all the possible pairs of AB. Okay? That's the definition of cross product. Okay? All the possible pairs such that A from set A and B is from set B. Is this clear? Not. Yeah.
So in the previous slide when you had SID produce the cross perform the cross product on those two IDs?
No, on the entire record. So these are set, right? So A and B are set. So this small A and small B represent the whole element from that set, not just some partial attribute of that element.
Okay. Is there any sort of performance?
Performance, yeah, I will talk about the performance issue next, after we understand the semantics. So let me give you some concrete example of this, right? So, for example, A is, and B is, okay, what is A cross B? By definition, it is simply the definition of A cross B, right? So if A is like something like this, it's a pair. So A itself is a pair. So the elements in A are pairs of elements. Then this will become point is it match every single element in its entirety with the entirety of the other element from the other set and produce all such pairs. So that's a cross product. So you do the cross product. So what's the cost of producing the cross product, by the way? If each set has n elements, what's the cost of doing the cross product?
N squared.
N squared, right? You have to do n squared. Can someone argue why you have to do n squared?
You have to pair every element on the first set with every element on the other side?
Well, that's if you do this part but in this particular fashion. How can you prevent or tell me there's no other way producing the cross product, that's less than n squared? Because if you do it this way, what you describe is one particular way of how to do it. And that particular way of how to do it leads to n squared cost.
Okay, well,
that's clear.
You're producing n squared elements.
That's the argument I'm looking for. No matter how you do it, even if you're as powerful as somebody that's up there, at the end of the day, if your goal is to produce the cross product, you have to print out n squared elements. That's the lower bound of your cost. There's no way you can avoid doing that. Right? So the first product is n squared from clause. What about the where clause? The where clause follows after the from clause, which what you do is, once you have the cross product, you do a for loop over every element in the set of your cross product, and then check the conditions specified in the where clause. For the element from the cross product that satisfies those where conditions, you keep them. Otherwise, you throw away them. Okay? Finally, for the remaining elements from the cross product who have survived the condition check from the where clause, you purge that out, you do the vertical selection, which is the select clause. Okay? So that's the select, from where select clause. So, so taking this example, these are my input for this query. So first thing I will do is I produce the cross product of the two. How many records I will have in the cross product? I will have 12 records in the cross product, right? 4 times 3, that's 12. And every element in the cross product will have all 8 attributes. Right? Just like it's a matching of pair of elements in their entirety from the two sets. So 5 attributes from the student and 3 attributes from the row. We're going to pair together, forming a record with 8 elements, or 8 attributes. So that's what you get. And this is the result of the cross product. And from this cross product, you do a for loop, and you check the where condition. And for this particular one, only this record will satisfy the where condition, because the student ID are the same, and course ID is 8. There are some other attributes, some other records from the course product where one of the two conditions is met, meaning either course ID is A, a course grade is A, or student ID matches against each other, but not both of them. That's why only one record will be kept. And then for this record, you do the final select statement, which is the selection on the vertical direction, put out the student name and course ID. Okay? So some of you might have realized, okay, fine, this tells me what this query does. But this is a really inefficient way of doing this query, right? Because for two tables, each table has n elements, this boils down to n squared. Because you have to produce this cross product, which is n squared. And the linear scan is as another n squared, but in big O notation, that's n squared. 2 n squared is n squared. For 3 tables, this becomes n cubed. For 4 tables, this becomes n to the power 4. And I'll quickly get out of control. Right? So for example, I want to find among the US population who is friend with whom. What do you do? Well, you take the US population, join them together and check every pair. That's essentially what you do. You select friends from US population and US population. And what's the cost of that? That's a big number, right? If you really do it using this cross-product approach, imagine Facebook try to do that, Facebook will be out of business. Because I just want to find my friend and take forever to do just that. We're going to use a website like that. Okay? So obviously, database system does something different than that. And that goes back to the point I made earlier. You as database developer or users, you only specify what you want. This is exactly what you want. And to help you understand what you are expressing, this is what you are expressing. That this is the semantic. Note that this is really the semantics of your query. In reality, this is never the way the database kernel will execute this query. Database engine will never do something like this because nobody will ever use a database engine who does something like this. It's too slow. So that's the end of the discussion on relation model. A quick summary of relation model, you need to understand the concept of schema, the concept of instance, the concept of super key, the concept of keys, the concept of primary key and candidate key, then foreign key, referential integrity constraint, some basic understanding of DDL, VML, and this important notion of what and how. Okay, that's the relation model. Next, we will move on to ER to relation model mapping. So we talk about ER, and then we have relation model. Relation model is something goes into your database engine, right? ER does not. ER is a diagram that models your data from your specification, and at the end of the day, database systems store tables, schema, and instance. So once you have your design in ER, somehow you need to map them to these tables, somehow, right? So is there a systematic way of doing that? That's essentially what we're going to answer next. The answer is yes, there are ways to do that. So that's, you know, what we will do is, actually this part is fairly straightforward. What we will do is go through each component in ER one by one and tell you or explain to you how a particular component in ER will be mapped to a schema in your relational model. We start with entity set. The rule is very simple. For entity set, every single entity set will be mapped to a relational schema. Will be mapped to a separate relational schema. So for example, if you have a student entity set like that, it will be mapped to this schema right here, with a corresponding query table statement like that. You may wonder where the instances come from. ER design, you know, doesn't really care about the instance of your entities or relationships. But imagine you have some entity like that, this will be mapped to those instance, that instance over there. Of course, this is not a good example because if you have five records here and only three there. Imagine you have either three here or five here. So the entities become records in your instance. Okay, that's a way to understand that. So this is a fairly straightforward, right? And in this mapping, you need to figure out what is the key of your schema. And if you have multiple keys, you will choose one of them as your primary key and the others as candidate keys. In this simple example, there's only one key, SSN, and that will be my primary key. Okay? It's very simple. Relationship to tables. This is a little bit more complicated. This is a little bit more complicated. Due to the fact that we have let's start with this. The basic one here. Right. Due to the fact that we have these different kinds of relationship sets, one to many, many to many, and one to one. Okay? To translate many to many, the simplest form of a relationship set is very simple. If you have a many to many mapping for your relationship set, that many to many relationship set will be mapped to a separate table, will be mapped to a separate table. Let me give you a concrete example. So employee works in department, right? And let's say I want to capture from when to when you work in that car. And the corresponding, because I have no errors whatsoever, so this is a many-to-many map. In other words, an employee may work for multiple departments, and the department may have multiple employees working in that department. For example, you will have something like that. Right? That's the example, right? Does that make sense? To understand how we map this to a table, fundamentally what you want to do is to have a way to capture these lines, to represent all these lines. Once you have a way to represent these lines, you're done, right? So a simple approach to that is to simply have a table called with the schema of this, obviously you need to have from and to. Those two attributes, because each line will have from and to. F and T, attached to each line. So that should be captured in your schema. For the table to store these lines, you need to capture those two attributes, obviously. Right? What other things you will need? Well, it goes back to the discussion I had from last lecture about the keys, right? To uniquely identify a line here, what do you have to do?
Do you need the primary keys of employees and departments?
You need the primary keys of the employee and departments, because once you have those two keys, you uniquely identify the two participating entities for a given line. That's equivalent to say you have uniquely identified that line itself. Does that make sense? So you will need to have employee ID and department ID. SSN and department ID. And that completes the mapping of this relationship set to a table. And what is the primary key for this table, by the way?
It's the SSN and the DID.
It's a combination of the two. Having just one of them is not good enough, because the same employee may work for multiple departments, which means the same SSN value may appear multiple times here. So does the DID value. So that's another way to show that this is actually the key. Because obviously this is a super key, it's unique. To show that it is a key, we have to show any subset of it is not a super key. So either SSN, neither SSN nor DID is a super key. So SSN and DID must be a key.
What if the employee starts working at two different times? So he starts at one day, gets terminated, and then starts working at the same
time. Well, if that's the case, that's a ternary relationship set, right? So we will talk about ternary relationship later on. Because you will model that as something called, like that. That's a different case. I will talk about that later on. So by the way, the example I give here is slightly different from the example here, because I didn't capture both. I don't care when you stop working for that job. I only care about things when you started working that job. So to be consistent with the example on the slide, I will change the ER design slide. Okay? All right. So that's management. Okay? Next, what about to understand one to many. So I leave that example on the left hand side. I will show another example on this side. I'm going to use the same employee and department, but now I'm going to use manage relationship set, which tells you which employee is the manager of a particular department. And in particular, I'm going to do my design like that. What does this mean? This means it's one to many mapping. In other words, not blocking you guys. Now, I can have design like that, but I cannot have, you cannot do this. This line is not allowed, right? Because it's one-to-many mapping. Each department can have only one manager, not more than one. So you, once you have a manager, you cannot have another manager. Does that make sense? But an employee can be manager of multiple departments. One to many. Okay? Does that make sense? Perfect. Okay. How do we map this to the relational model?
So it's similar where you have each of the attributes of the relationship, but then your primary key will now just be the primary key of departments.
Say again, can you repeat your answer?
So it'll be similar in that you still have the...
Similar to the work scene.
Yeah.
So what you're saying is...
So if you have like a from and a to, you'd still have that.
I'll manage, and that will have... And let's say I have a attribute called budget. Actually, let me be consistent with the slides example. Since when you are a manager. So what you're saying is this and... The primary key will be?
No, it'll just be that of departments because.
Okay?
Yeah.
Alright. So, versus, let me put up another. So, what is the difference of the two designs? What's the difference of two designs? He proposed this one, right? Can you explain to us why?
Yeah, so with the second one?
With the red design, red color design, yes.
With the red one where you have the SSN and the DID.
Okay.
That, its superset contains another super key, DID, because you could... There are no two members of that relationship with the same DID.
So I think I kind of get what you're saying. Let me try to rephrase and make it more concise, huh? So keep this in mind when we talk about this, the difference of two design, right? With this design, because the key is DID and SSN, what that tells you is the fact that this is the key implies that are not super keys. Otherwise, this cannot be the key by definition of the key. So these two cannot be the super key. Otherwise, this cannot be the key, right? By definition of key, right? What is the key? It must be a super key. And none of its proper subset is a super key. The fact that you are using this as a key means that these two cannot be the super key. Does that make sense? And what this statement tells you? Well, what SSN, let's don't care about this. What this tells you is DID is not a super key. In other words, same DID value can appear multiple times because once you are not a super key, records can have same values on that attribute. And what's wrong with that? Well, there's obviously wrong with our design because each department can only have how many members? One. But if you allow department ID value to appear multiple times, that is to say you allow the department to have multiple managers. Wrong. Question?
Can we make DID unique as well?
Make DID unique. Where?
If we're constructing the SQL command.
The idea is unique in the department table, but not in the managed table. It is unique in the department. It is a key for the department table, right? Obviously. The idea is unique in the department table, but that says nothing about whether the idea is unique in the managed table.
Right. Well, could you make it unique in the managers table?
Well, that's the way to make it. Make it the key. Right? So this design is bad because of that. It allows department to have multiple managers. Does that make sense? Whereas SSN is not super key, that's okay. SSN is not super key means the same SSN value may appear multiple times in the managed table, but that's okay, that's exactly what we want. The same person can be manager of multiple departments. Whereas in this case, you cannot use DID as a key, because if you do that, what that tells you is you each department only, can only appear once in the working table. What that tells you?
Only one
employee can work in that department. It's not what we want. You have a question?
Yeah, how do you enforce the every department to have exactly one manager rather than no manager?
Okay. That's another subtle, excellent question. Let me repeat the question. Is how do we enforce each department have exactly one manager? That's actually different from what this design, right? Because this design says you can have one manager, but doesn't mean you have to have one manager. I can have a department having no manager. To do exactly what you have to do, you do total population constraint. You follow me? That will invalidate this instance, will force you to choose manager. Let's say I choose that one. Let's backtrack. Let's say I'm not discussing that case for now. Okay, we'll come to that point very quickly. But for now, we're talking about this particular thing. Each partner have up to one manager. You can have no manager, that's okay. If you choose to have one, you can only have one manager. But what you're saying is exactly one. You must have one and exactly one manager, right? That's a slightly different problem. So now I want I hope everyone is with me that this is not okay design. Okay? Not okay. Of course you can argue, wait a minute. I'm smart, I know what I'm doing. Yes, I'm using this design, but I will ensure I use only one manager for that department. Does that make sense?
What if someone else uses it?
Kind of, yes, let's say I trust you, but what if you leave my company, somebody else, take over your job, and he or she either doesn't fully understand your design, that somewhere embedded in your code, messy C++ Java code, or he or she is not as competent as you, will start inserting multiple manager record into this. Right? So, no, not a good design. Whereas in this case, that works. Right? So this is one way to do one-to-many manager. Okay? Which is convert the relationship set to a table itself for that one-to-many manager. Now, how do we do what he had asked? Which is exactly one manager. To do that, using this design, it's actually very tricky to do that because first of all, you need to use this design. This tells you at most one manager. To say exactly one, what you have to do is every DID value that has ever appeared in the department table must also appear in this table. That will enforce at most one and exactly one. Right? But that's tricky to do, right? How do you do that? That brings up exactly my next point. So this design is okay, but it's not perfect. What's a better design for one-to-many manager? Well, let's go back to this diagram right here. Okay, listen carefully. In order to capture, the objective is to capture all these lines, right? One way to do that is to have a table to encapsulate all these lines, like what we have done. Then there's a subtle difference between these two. And we go with this design. Another approach, once you know it's one-to-many, what's the significance of that? Well, if you look at each of these entities from the department side, each of these entities, you know one thing, once you know it's one main, there can be only one incoming run, guaranteed. There can be only one incoming line to me, guaranteed, it's 90 and 90 harmony. And to identify that line, all I need to do is to take the corresponding SSM value, attach that to the department entity. So imagine this is SSM. So I just do 1, and this is 3. This is 4, and this is 1. And the dot itself represents all the other attributes of the department itself. Does that make sense? It works. Of course, if the line itself has some attributes, you want to capture those attributes over and above, whatever that is. This is as good as if you're representing this line in a separate table. But now the benefit is, there are two benefits. One is, you no longer need this table at all. Because this relationship become part of your department's table. You follow me? That's benefit number one. Benefit number two goes back to his question. Now I can enforce that you must have a manager by saying, SSN must be null. You cannot have a null value for SSN. In other words, whenever you try to insert a record into the department, you need to specify a value for SSN. In other words, you need to have a manager. And this is exactly one. Okay, you follow this enough? You may wonder, okay, can I come back, take this design to here? Let's try. It's management, right? Remember? So what I have to do? I have to keep the dots, that's the department itself. And for this one, I need to have two SSNs. Then I have two managers. For the second dot, I only have one SSN. Immediately you see a problem with this design, right? It's no longer structured. The structure of each record is different from the other records. Because you don't know how many managers a department may have. 1, 2, 3, 4, or 0. How can you reflect that in your schema? Impossible. Schema is to specify the structure for all records. You follow me? So the only approach, if you were to do this, the only possible way to do that is what? Is to specify a schema with the maximum number of managers any department may have. Let's say, if I tell you the maximum number of managers for any department is 6, so you're going to have SSN 1 or all the way to SSN 6. But with this design, for a lot of departments, those 6 attributes will be, a lot of them will be null values. Because I only have one manager. I cannot specify the value for the other 5. There may be only one department somewhere you fill up all the 6 fields. But for most others, you're wasting those attributes. It's a bad design. It works, but it's a really bad design. That's why we go with this approach. For many to many, and for one to many, so the summary, okay? For one to many, you do not convert the relationship to a table itself. Rather, you take the primary key from the one side and place the primary key from the one side into the many side, into the table for the many side. In other words, this versus this. And you always take the second approach. You do not do that first approach. You follow me? This is all the department stuff. This is the manager. This is James. And the primary key stay at the department ID, and the SSN is a foreign key reference to the employees. So you do not need that table on top. these guys, the first three attributes, is the thoughts. Okay? What about total population constraint? What else? Well, this one is hidden, right? For one too many, that's either you specify SSN as not null, so that every department must have an SSN value, meaning must have a manager. But what about this? Meaning every employee works for a department and at least one department, and each department has at least one employee working in that department. How do I specify that? This design does not address that. Because what this design gives you is an employee may work for multiple departments and department may have multiple employees working in that department. It says nothing that an employee must appear in this table or a department must appear in this table. So it does nothing whatsoever with respect to enforcing those two total participation constraints. Do you follow me? How do we fix that?
Use the not null constraint for both.
Well, if you use not null here, good attempt, but it doesn't work. First of all, the fact that the combination of them are primary key means that they cannot be null. Anyway. And now, and even if you specify that, and in addition to the fact that its primary key is automatically enforced already, it only says for any record who appears in the working table, it must have an SSN and DID value. This is not equivalent to say every SSN must appear in the working table, or every department ID must appear in the working table. Two different things. The reason that this works, using only a not null works, is that you're in the department table itself. The fact that you are saying not null means that this is a department record. Does that make sense? You are in the department table itself. So you are literally doing this for each department. That's why it works, not for the management. To enforce this, unfortunately, what we have learned so far, the machinery we have learned so far, is not enough. Sometimes, you know, this happens in life too, you just need to accept that you haven't learned enough to tackle the problem. It's good to say, okay, I can do anything. Like Nike's commercial says, nothing is impossible. Well, in reality, there are things that's indeed impossible, beyond which, accept the reality. Actually, this is, a lot of times people feel, it's bad to say, this is impossible to accept failures or accept your incapability. Actually, I see that's the power of you, to accept that there are things you cannot do. Because only if you realize that there are things you cannot do, that motivates you to do more. If you say, okay, I can do anything, I can do anything, what I'm doing here, why I'm teaching this class, why I'm making money, I can do anything, right? I don't have to do anything anymore. Right? So always accept your incapability that motivates you to do more. Okay, so we accept the fact that, okay, it's beyond what we can do now. We just have to learn a little bit more. So we will defer this to some later discussion. But one too many total participation constraint, that's possible. Lastly, what about one to one? What about one to one? For one to one, you can treat it either as many to one or one to many. It's a special case of one of the two. In other words, you can take the primary key from one set and place that into another set. It doesn't matter how you do it. All right, we're almost there. Is a hierarchy. To translate is a hierarchy to relational model, there are two different approaches. The first approach is very simple. It's that you have three entity sets. Yes, one is parent, the other are two children entity sets. I don't care about that. I will take the three entity sets and convert them into three separate tables. I have one table for employees, one table for hourly employee, and one table for contract employee. What's interesting is what goes into those schema, right? What attributes goes into those schemas. For the employee table, that's clear, right? You take all the attributes for the employee entity set and place that into the employee table. What goes into hourly employee and contract employees?
It inherits all the attributes. attributes from the above
okay.
entity as well as its own attributes.
So what you are suggesting is take all the attributes from employee and add those to the entity set specific attributes, and that form the schema, right? If you already have the employee table, you actually don't have to do that, because all you need to do is to take the primary key out of your parent table, and that gives you a way to refer back to those attributes in the parent table to complete the record. What you have proposed works too, but that introduces unnecessary duplications for the values of name and lot in this example for those records. And duplication is actually a very bad thing. Not only it introduces storage and query overhead because you have to deal with more data, but introduce all sorts of problems, like insertion and update anomaly, what I mean by that. So imagine if you have the name and lot values for the same employee duplicated in the employee table and in the hourly employee table. Suppose it's hourly employee record. And later on, I want to update the lot value for this record. I need to update now two places. Doesn't sound like a big deal, but imagine right after you are finishing updating one, system crash. What you end up with are two inconsistent values for the same record. Does that make sense? Update is not atomic, huh? System may crash right after one. So that we will have more discussion on that later on as well, transactions. So that's one approach, three papers. However, another possible approach is when you have covering constraint is true. Refresh yourself, what is covering constraint? Covering constraint means that the union of the two children entity sets give you all entities from the parent entity set. Meaning an employee is either an hourly employee or a contract employee. There are no employee who is neither of the class. When that's the case, you don't have to take the three table approach. You can actually do only two tables. Now you have to do what you have suggested, which is take all the attributes from the employee table and add them to each of your children entity set and make each of them a table. So you have two tables, one called hourly employee and one called contract employee. The hourly employee will have five attributes, the contract employee will have four attributes. And this only works if covering constraint is true, when the union of two give you all employees, for a reason that's obvious, right? Otherwise, if you only have these two tables and you have somebody who is not an hourly employee and not a contract employee but still an employee, this approach doesn't work. You have to go back to the three table approach when covering constraint is not true. Okay? So that's how you convert insert hierarchy. So there's a quick summary of this. Now to quickly recap what we have discussed, I'll give you this picture representation of the mappings. For an entity set with this, it goes to a table like that. All the attributes with the key. For a many-to-many mapping, it goes to three tables. So which I ignored the table for E and E1 and E2 because this, view this graph recursively, right? This is that, and there is a table for R1. Okay? That's how you map it. Okay? Does that make sense? For one-to-many, what do you do? One is this, but we argue that this is the bad approach for the reason I explained. Another possible approach is to do only this. But again, that's not an ideal design either, right? So what we have discussed is ignore R1, you convert E1 just as a normal entity set, and convert E2 into this plus the primary key from E1 and all the attributes from the relationship set. And if you have total possibility constraint on the E2 side, you make A1 not. But another, pay attention, though, another thing I want to mention is this not null trick works if the total participation constraint is on the E2 side. What if you have a total participation constraint on E1 side? Meaning, what if it's like this? Does this not null approach work? It actually does not, right? Because this only said each department must have a manager, because the SSM value is not null. But it never says that every SSN must appear in the department table as a manager. Does that make sense? So this null trick only works on the many side. It doesn't work for the one side. And how do you take care of that? Well, again, that's something beyond what we can do now, and we have to come back and visit that later. So in general, this is a quick summary of what you do for each multiple cases. Okay? So you can review this yourself. And for hierarchy, there are two approaches. The second approach is only possible if you have current constraints satisfied. What about ternary relationship set? Well, ternary relationship, you just treat it as a binary relationship. You have three tables for each entity set and one table for the relationship set. Okay? By taking all the keys. Very simple. Okay? Lastly, what about aggregation? Very similar to the ternary relationship set, what you do is the three entities as before, meaning each goes to a table, as well as for that relationship set between E1 and E2 within aggregation. If it's a one-to-one, if it's a many-to-many, it goes to a table itself. If it's a one-to-many or many-to-one, it goes to one of the tables. If it's one-to-one, you treat it as one-to-many or many-to-one. So it's just as before. For R2, this one, you treat it just like kind of like a ternary relationship set. What you do is you take the primary keys from the participating entity set and create a table with all the attributes to the relationship set itself. So in other words, aggregation is very similar to, in some sense, similar to the ternary, except that in aggregation, except that in aggregation, you have that additional R1 to deal with inside the aggregation to deal with. And that's not the case for a ternary relation set. With that, I'm done. Okay? I see you on Monday. I'll give you 2 minutes back, which I reserve for you. So now you can do everything in your homework. Everything in your homework is covered.
So I think it's this one, right?
Did I do?